So today we'll speak about data science, and this lecture will be kind of a general overview of data science field, because first reason is we don't have enough time to go through all the aspects. It will probably take 1 year. And the second thing is that, based on my experience, a lot of our colleagues are not familiar what the hell is data science. So I think this presentation should be very useful for them. Generally, data science is a pretty new term. It consists of several different fields. For example, you can see statistics, machine learning, data mining, etc. There are a lot of different definitions for data science, and there's a huge argument between different groups. So whether you have like one point of people who thinks that data science is actually not a science at all. Then you have guys who say, well, data science is just a new word for statistics, etc. But what is important now to know is that data science is practically a set of interdisciplinary fields that is able to extract useful knowledge from the data. And I think that's pretty enough for our presentation. Why to become data scientist? This is like, just you can see here a graph regarding current jobs for data scientists. And you can see that in the last period, it is just skyrocketing. And I can tell you from my personal experience that recruiters are totally crazy. They're like attacking and jumping on you. And really, there are a lot of jobs. The reason why this situation is happening is this next graph. So here, now in this paper, on this graph, you can see that the quantity of data is really exploding. And the companies have solved the problem of data storage. So that's not a problem. But the biggest problem is that they don't have enough manpower, which is very, very good for us, because we can then get better salaries. Okay, so what skills do you need? I guess the probably majority of you guys here have some programming background, and that's really good start. When you have a programming background, then I think the next place where you should concentrate is machine learning. That will take some time, and also understanding of some basic statistics will help. This is Venn's diagram for the skills, and you can see that this guy who created this wrote in the middle is like unicorn. So we are trying to present ourselves like some unique beings, like omnipotent beings that our clients should pay a lot. Just to summarize, if you have programming background, then start learning machine learning and expand step by step. Toolkit. So what are the tools we are using? There are several things. First line is R for programming languages. R, probably nobody's familiar. Is somebody like ever heard? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Whoa, oh, great, cool. So normally, like people, when I say, just hear me talking about R, they're like, what is that? It's really, really good thing. It's a little bit complicated to learn, unfortunately. But I think 50 or even 60% of data scientists is using it. So I think it's very, very important to learn that. The next thing is Python. That's surprisingly, in the last few years, Python community generated like two very useful libraries, which are great for machine learning specifically, and generally for scientific computing. So if you guys are familiar with Python, I would suggest you to start with Python. Next thing, Scala, really great. Specifically, it is great for machine learning and distributed systems. So it should be used with Spark, and that's the second line, Apache Spark, amazing thing. Something that I believe it will be really, really important in the next few years, especially due to the fact that, as I said, the companies are having huge problems. They have the data, but they don't know how to extract the value from the data. And in the, let's say, conservative way was you have one node, you have some certain amount of RAM, and you do things. But today, that's not valid anymore. So Apache Spark is pretty good platform for that. They have like machine learning library, and I suggest you to learn Scala and use it there. Also, they have like bindings for R, for Java, for Python, but the things are happening really fast. The code, the new code is originally written in Scala, so then you have to wait for certain functionality to be implemented in the API, for example, in R or Python, so you're just losing valuable time. Then I have put the list with Hadoop and Mahout. Well, Hadoop just for maybe data storage. We'll see what will happen with Hadoop. It seems that the Spark momentum is really great, and it's possible that Spark will just overtake the Hadoop as well. And interesting example is Mahout. That was that is still a set of machine learning algorithms that was written in MapReduce pattern. It was running on Hadoop. It was like top 2 years ago. Like all my clients were like Mahout, Mahout. Today it's dead. The guy who was the main committer for Mahout, the Sean Owen, he just went. He's now committing code for Spark, and I think that's a very, very good sign where we should focus. Next thing is ETL. Not sure whether you're familiar with ETL thing. So it's like extract, transform, load. You take data from one source, you do some transformation, example, you're cleaning data or just merging data from different sources, and you load to some place, maybe some database or something like that. I would suggest you to use a Pentaho data integration, because often you have to, you have a client and has data all over the place, so you need some tool which enables you with drag and drop to quickly create transformations and jobs that will just extract data and put it where you want them. Of course, relational databases, of course, NoSQL, so definitely, because that's like the typical data sources these days. Then you have here like SPSS and SAS, those are some commercial applications for data science used by some bigger companies, older. I don't think it's very relevant anymore, but it's very rare to find any openings for these. So I think it's just going down the slope. For beginners, this last line, very interesting, like Weka. Really good for starting and learning, especially if you're a Java developer. I would strongly and warmly suggest you to start using Weka, because it has two parts. It has like graphical interface where you can easily just click there and on a few buttons you can load the data and do some interesting stuff. So it's very good for learning. Also, they have a library which you can just call from your application. So you can use it, but it's not good for production because it's a little bit slower. So I would not suggest you to use it for production, but generally you can use it in order to learn and maybe do some quick proof of concept and that kind of stuff. Also, there are competing companies like Knime and RapidMiner, pretty good. So that's worth exploring as well. Okay, so how to become a data scientist? When I was at the university, here in Novi Sad, unfortunately, we never talked about that. And I suggest, like, I think all of you guys are already completed your university. So the only thing I think is good is to start learning on Coursera. There are like two amazing things. One is data science specialization. It will take some time. It's like 9 times, like each one is 4 weeks. So it will take time. But the advantage is that you really go from the beginning to the end of like getting the data, cleaning data, etc., and you end up with creating the product, and it's all in R. So it's great for learning R. You get like really good knowledge. The next thing is a classic on Coursera, probably the most famous. Machine learning class is by Stanford University and Professor Andrew, and I always have problem with his last name. I think it's Vietnamese or something like that. Really amazing, because the guy is going deep into the math, and you get to learn like how it is functioning in details. Of course, as I said, like due to the fact that we're living in big data world today, definitely your clients will sooner or later have a scalability issues. So for learning like how to do different models in distributed manner, I strongly suggest like Eric's, and there's like scalable machine learning by Berkeley University. They have like clusters of Spark machines, and you should use Python there. So maybe if you're familiar with Python, this would be very, very good thing to do. Okay, so this is like this is from Wikipedia, not very beautiful, but just to give you like an idea how is all this data science process go. So we always start with data. If you don't have data, you don't have nothing. So I have like one client saying, well, give me an estimate and how you're going to do it, but I don't have data. So data science, we need data to do some work, to do some science on that. The biggest issue today in data science is that when you get data, so it's so dirty. Sometimes you are shocked, like what kind of and what level of junk data they are today in various data sources. So you have to clean it. And unfortunately, some estimates say that we are losing 80% time on probably the most boring part of the data science. But that's still issue in this field. Once the data is processed, when you clean the stuff out, when you have all the data, you call it like tidy data, so at least you can load it, like, let's say in R or in some other language, then you can start with exploratory data analysis to see like whether you can drop some features, or maybe you can create some new features, or what you can do with that. And once you have finished all that, then you go to models to create like predictive models, for example. For example, if you have a classification, then you start going in the iterations, trying to tune your model and see whether you're able to predict, to make good predictions. In this part, it's extremely important to have metrics. Metrics help you to just compare, because let's say you have a recommendation engine and then you create a new version. So what is better? You don't know. So you have to have some scientific backing of your claims that algorithm A is better than algorithm B. And you can get that from two sources. One source is just plain from the mess. You have training set, you have test set, and you create model on training set, and then on test set you try to see how good is performing, and you have some metrics. And the second thing is to get from the users. For example, you have a site with the recommendation engine, and their recommendations, and then you can trace from the front end like whether they are clicking or not, and you can make some kind of A/B tests. So you have like one stream going with the algorithm A recommendations, another stream going with algorithm B, and you compare. So that's very important to think about. Okay, so how much data do we need? I think this picture shows what do we like, generally, but maybe it's not good, but we are always data scientists, and I did that many times. We are trying to persuade or to force our clients to get us as more data as possible. Because when you have data, then you can do whatever you want. When you don't have the data, then it's a big problem. And I think like in USA, it's so relaxed that they are like actually selling data about your health, about your like mortgage, house, wife, kids. It's insane. Like, you can actually buy for like 200 million people, you can actually buy all the data about them. So actually I had one project where we were like gathering all that, and it's really helpful in order to create good predictions. Okay, so this was like the boring part. Now let's go to some use cases, just to give an example, like what are the things the data science is covering. Of course, not everything, it's too much, so I'll just go through a few of them. One of the problems I had like 2 years ago, this online dating site. And when you start with online dating site, a lot of Nigerian scam guys just show up and they are pretending to be somebody else. Either like beautiful lady. This is actual picture. This is this guy. and was pretending to be this girl. So you can imagine the surprise. So what they are doing is they are trying to get into romantic relationship, like through the messaging system, through the platform. And after a few, like maybe months or something, then, hey, I'm traveling to Nigeria, and then, whoa, I lost my wallet. You know the stories, like, please send me money on this account. And this is a huge problem. It's a huge problem. They're like professionals and they work in groups. And for some of them, it's relatively easy to catch them because they're using some pictures that are very popular. For example, there's a kind of a scam where they're pretending to be some veterans, so they're taking pictures of different American soldiers. So they took like betrayals, like generals, like famous people. So it's crazy. So those guys you can catch. But there are some clever guys which go like really step by step, and they're building the story. And we had to catch them as soon as possible because they're ruining like everything, and they can just ruin your business. So I created two step like ensemble of classifiers. The first one is based on Facebook. As I said a little bit before, we're trying to get all your data, and on this site, people were joined by clicking like, yeah, I allow to the Facebook. When you click, I allow, oh yeah. We take everything, all your pictures, all your Facebook likes, all your friends, everything. So the first classifier was based on the data from the Facebook, well, how many friends you have, etc. Now, next question was how to create a data set. You have to have like which are real ones, which are fake ones, and then let the machine make the algorithm, make the model for that. So we created a front end, had sampled like 1,000 random people from the database. We had three judges, people from marketing team and security team in the company. So they were going manually, one by one, and voting like fake, real, fake, real. And then you have three votes fake or three votes real, then you say, okay, this is fake, this is real. And the second thing was, the second classifier was a message-based classifier, where we have our clients were communicating through the messaging system on the platform. And yes, we are reading everything, of course. And these scammers, they have kind of stuff that I like to call like romantic scam poetry. It's really like some kind of, wow, I'm so romantic, and they're like kind of cheesy poetry, like you're so beautiful, blah, 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 that kind of stuff. And they're sending that mails. And literally you can transform all those messages from the real people, which are not scamming, and those that are scamming, to string to words. So you have like a representation of the words. You create, there's some math, but actually you can implement that just in four or five lines of R code. Also, it is existing in Spark as well. And from there, you can literally see that they are using some words more often than other words, and creating classifier on their messages and creating classifier on the Facebook based on Facebook data, we were able to create like the final prediction and to run against whole database. And then when you have somebody who is classified as a fake user, then you can say, okay, so from, we had like, I think on top we had like 80,000 users. We can say, you cannot go and check them all, especially if that scales to millions. But if you have a good classifier and says, okay, check these like 2,000 of guys, it's feasible and you can do that. And I'm really happy that we were able to clean these guys from the platform. Unfortunately, the platform is not functioning anymore, but this classifier was sold to another company, so it's still living somewhere, and I hope helping people. Okay, next thing, collaborative filtering. It's for recommendations. So everybody knows when you go to some website, you have some maybe movies or something, you like to see recommendations. And this is like the school example of recommendations. Very easy, very easily implemented, and it's giving good results. It's just like you have one person having like two CDs, maybe two movies, and you have another person that bought also the same two CDs, but it also bought the third one. So you can recommend that third one to the first person. You just say these users are similar. So that's user-based similarity. Of course, you can make the item similarity as well. And you create a big matrix. You have like user IDs, you have item IDs, and you actually don't care. You don't care what is it, movie, person, book, you don't care. You don't care. So you just care like you have IDs and it's math. And there's one funny story from my career. I had one client from Japan and he just sent me like all the data. And I was trying to get like information on what is it about, because I mean, at the same time, data scientist, but I want to sell my services. So I wanted to know more. Maybe I can suggest some content-based recommendations, etc. But he was just cleverly evading the answer, and no problem. I did several different this collaborative filtering algorithms. And finally, but it was the end of the job, of the project, a guy gave me the access, SSH access to the remote machine in Japan, where I had to like just put that in production. And when once I went there, I actually saw it was like porn site, this kind of anime porn site, it's really disgusting. It was working, but still, I said like, okay, give me my money and forget about me. Actually, the guy called like 1 month ago, he wants some changes, but no thanks. So be careful what you're doing. This is something which not very interesting maybe, but I want to present that as well, because even experienced data scientists don't have a clue how to solve these problems. This is like you have some signal and you want to predict what will happen in the future, and people don't know how to do that. And I saw some people that are charging some insane amounts of cash doing totally crazy stuff, like something totally useless. So generally, this quick example is just based on, you see, you have a signal, then you can make a decomposition of the signal to get the seasonal component, to get the trend, and you get the reminder or noise. And based on that, there's like really good work of Professor Hindman from Monash University in Australia that enables you, based on this, to create like predictions. And these predictions are awesome. For example, you want to predict how some products will be selling based on the previous data, or like each day, what will be the oscillation, or electricity consumption, or flights, like how many people are using some flight, etc., etc. It is not good example for probably somebody of you thought, like, oh, I can use this for, I don't know, Forex, or I can use this for futures trading, the kind of stuff. So it's not good for that. Be careful. We spend like, I don't know, 1 year trying to beat some trading algorithms on this, but it's not good for that. Okay, these are not my kids. don't call social service. This is the reason why I wanted to show this is really famous like urban legend from the data science world that it's like market basket analysis. It is a story about Walmart having a data scientist team, and they have like each day they have people going to shop and buying stuff. So we know that beer and peanuts, they go together, right? So when you go to Mercator, you see on one side you have beer, on the other side you have like snacks, or it's clothes. So they're thinking like they want to increase the sales, so people will just buy one another. But these data scientists that were working for Walmart, they established the correlation that people were buying like Thursday or Friday night diapers, that's why babies on the picture, and beer at the same time. And that's something that nobody expected to see. So then this story goes that then they used on Thursday, they put like, or on Friday, they put like where the diapers are, they put some kind of commercial like this beer is on discount. And then they make some kind of research, and explanation is next. So the young fathers that like to go out, drink beer with their friends, when they get babies and the wife send them to buy diapers, and they're like, okay, I'm gonna have a six pack, at least I can drink it at my home. So that's why I put this picture. This is anecdote. I'm not sure if it happened real or not. But this is something which you can use for that kind of problem. So you have a lot of transactions and you want to see what is going together, and then you make some useful useful, get that useful data from that. Yeah, this picture is related to Mr. Šabić and NSA. Maybe if somebody's interested for some startup, this could be very interesting stuff. This is just starting to be really, really hot currently. So just imagine you have a site, you have a client, and it has like maybe 3,000 converted clients. They're paying some subscription or something. And also, he had some people that just came to the site, but unfortunately, they didn't convert. They're just leads. They said, okay, I'm not interested, and they went to some other place. So you have some small amount of data about those people. You have maybe name, maybe email, and that kind of stuff. And now you want to scale your business. You want to find more customers. Everybody wants more customers. So what you can do is you take your guys, like that you have data, just a little piece of data, and then you go to the data providers. As I said, in USA, you can buy like everything, like all the possible stuff. Like the latest I saw was like 249 features for a person, like whether he wants sports, animals, it's totally crazy. I don't know where they're gathering all the data. Of course, not all data are populated for every person, but the numbers of the how many data they have is really like amazing. And then you get the features for your converted and features for your leads, and then you can create a model. Once you create a model, then you can run that model against 1,000 or 100,000 or 1 million people from the database and get, let's say, top 10% of those that are likely to convert. And those are your target areas. So you can then do the old good stuff like spam them, send them emails, or you can use techniques like try to find them. Like there are some companies that are actually tracing people on the net, and you can send them your list about these people. When they find them on some sites, they put in like some kind of cookie with a specific ID, and then you go to Facebook, you go to LinkedIn or some other site or Google, and you say, so whoever shows up with the cookie with this ID, put our commercial, like trying to get. So it's kind of retargeting, but a little bit more advanced based on this. So I think this is going to be really, really big stuff very soon. And finally, this is a very important site, Kaggle.com. I'm not sure for how to pronounce correctly, but the strength of this platform is they have all the time different kind of data science competitions. Please don't expect that you will won any of those, because people who are competing there are either employed like in university, so they have a lot of time, or they're working in some kind of bureaus for statistics. Again, they're paid by government, so they have plenty of time. They don't have to think about income. So they compete, and they're pretty good. But the value of this site is its forum, and people are really exchanging, and people are encouraged to share different scripts and different ideas and algorithms. So it's pretty amazing to see and to learn. So you can start with that as well. Okay, thank you very much.